So, first of all, thanks the organizers for inviting me to this very nice conference and also to have the opportunity to discuss this nice paper that I liked a lot. Okay. There is any issue with the microphone yet? Okay, perfect. Okay, thank you. So, first of all, disclaimer, I like a lot the paper, so I think I will be overall very constructive in the discussion. It's still very preliminary, but I think it's very promising. So the draft that I received so contains mainly the model, but I think that there is a lot to learn and to extract from the paper. Very briefly, the summary of the paper so starts from three different stylized facts, so an increase in income inequality in Germany. Where we, by income inequality, we means by looking at the top 10% of the income share, as opposed to the rest of the euro area. The decline in the natural rate of interest and the German export surplus that we have seen increasing during the period. And they try to reconcile these three stylized facts in a very, I would say, simple but also clean model with two countries in the baseline version that I think is still very useful despite its simplicity. Two countries, Germany and the rest of the euro area, and basically heterogeneous agents. So these top 10% that are sort of capitalists, so they have these capitalist spirit preferences, and so they have a higher marginal propensity to save as opposed to the rest of the households. And workers. And what do they find? They try different sources of inequality, the markups, and the relative human capital productivity. They find that basically an exogenous income inequality, when we have an exogenous increase in income inequality, we have a fall in consumption in Germany, an increase in savings because there is a redistribution toward these households that have a higher preference for savings. And this leads to a reduction in the natural rate of interest and into an increase in the net exports of Germany as opposed to the rest of the world and as opposed to the rest of the euro area. And the result is robust to different specification on the model. And let's say, in the specification with three countries, the one that Ansgar presented, is able to explain around 50-60% of the net exports surplus that we have observed in the last decade. So basically, my comments, suggestions, clearly, so Ansgar was also referencing some papers, but I think that it's important. It's a possible complement factor alternative story that is basically, I would say, almost observationally equivalent unless we find a variable over which the two stories can differ, that is demographics. Then I think that the paper can be a very nice narrative to introduce and to look at the imbalances that drove the euro area to the 2011 sovereign crisis. And finally, I think that there is an alternative story that has to be tested in the model, and the model can be used to understand the quantitative impact of TFP divergence across the euro area. So, as you may remember, some years ago, it was a very hot topic in the literature, the good old days in which we had inflation below target, we had short-term rate close or at the zero lower bound, and we were wondering how we could stimulate even more the economy given the current situation, and we were wondering what were the causes of this fall in the natural rate. And we had basically two opposed teams, the financial cycle teams that was sort of arguing that because of debt overhang that was coming from the inheritance of the great financial crisis, from the fact that central banks were stimulating a lot the economy through low rates, was lowering even more the natural rate of the economy. At the opposite, you had the sort of demographics team starting from very famous idea of Larry Summers of the secular stagnation hypothesis that basically told you that because of aging in the Western world, you had a fall in the natural rate of interest. The main idea behind these demographics is that you have more marginal propensity to consume that varies across the life cycles. Usually, younger households have a higher marginal propensity to consume. They also can be sometimes borrowing constrained, while older households, and especially middle age close to retirements, tend to save more for their retirement. So, in an environment in which baby boomers were in Western world being so aging and they were getting closer to retirement, you had an increase in savings, and then through market clearing of savings of capital, you had a decrease in the natural interest rate. And if you think about this hypothesis inside an open economy, so if, like you say, you extend a bit the point, I know two papers that do this, one by Papetti and former colleague at the Bank of Italy, and one by Lisa Ketale, I think, Bank of England, in which basically these models are also able to predict that you have a current account surplus in those countries where baby boomers are in the middle age and are getting closer to retirement, and an increase in the net foreign asset position. So, yes, yeah, so for example, if you look, sorry, what did it? Thank you. So if you look at Germany, or here in the Papetti simulation, you already get that you should have a positive change in net foreign asset to GDP given the change in the old dependency ratio that you observe. So I completely understand that you cannot fully address this issue into the model, because clearly it's not an overlapping generation model, but I think that it's an important alternative story that has to be discussed, and eventually also to be found a way to pin down which of the two prevails, or I mean, maybe they are just complement. Then let me go so when I read the paper, I had the impression that, so it was reminding me of some stylized facts that were not cited that I knew. And I remember of this speech by Constancio, the former vice president of the ECB, in which basically he was explaining and providing some stylized facts of the build-up of the 2011 crisis. It is publicly known as the sovereign spread crisis or the sovereign debt crisis, but what he was showing was that at least in the beginning it was not so sovereign. And in particular, if you look at, let's say, the stressed country, and if you look at the public sector debt to GDP ratio before the crisis, before the 2008 crisis, you can see that for many of them, the fiscal consolidation, like Italy, Spain, and Ireland mostly, was above the euro area average. So it was not, they were not countries that were running larger deficit than the rest of the euro area. What was true was that they were increasingly, massively, their private debt. So the issue was much more on the private than on the public. And where this debt was coming from, if you looked at the flows, the cumulative growth of exposures of banks from core countries, so non-stressed core countries like France or Germany, to come back to the paper, you had that their exposures toward banks of stressed country was increasing a lot. And at the same time, private credit was accumulated in the core countries and was given to the peripheral countries and was increasing massively in the stressed, what would have been then the stressed countries. And the speech was not going into current account and inflations, but I did it by myself. And basically I find that indeed, if you look at clearly the current account, so while the Germany, the blue line, was, as we have seen already in Ansgar presentation, going up, we had a massive deterioration of current account in Spain, Greece, Ireland, Italy, and Portugal. And okay, and then like you have a sort of closures of these. So then they close only when the crisis hits, and then they are forced through fiscal consolidation to reduce consumption. And indeed, that also was a bit surprising when I read the paper, because like there was this implicit disinflation in Germany that I didn't remember about it. So I went to check and is there. So let's say, I would say that all these stylized facts can constitute a nice narrative for the paper. So let's say, I think that your paper basically tells us that the increase in income inequality can indeed be amongst the triggers of this imbalances that we have observed in the euro area and that basically were they constitute the basis for then the 2011 crisis. And finally, clearly there were many other things going up, so I don't want to say that this was the only reason for the 2011 crisis. But for example, if you look at TFP, so there was a massive divergence in TFP. Here I've plotted Germany, that is the blue line, France, that is the green line, and then just for like to give an example, Italy, Spain, and Portugal, that has these three lines that are going down. So between 1990 and 2011, so again to stay in the crisis, you had a huge divergence for several reasons. So Germany, for example, you had the catch-up of the eastern part of the country. You had political reforms, labor market reforms, for example, in Germany. And so while maybe peripheral or stressed countries were lagging behind. So I think that already as it is your model, you can either use the TFP as a source of inequality, probably. I think that it should go in that direction. For sure should determine current account imbalances, deflation in Germany, and all the other things that that you have in your model right now. So I think that can also be an alternative source, and you can also make a quantitative assessment of how much was coming from TFP growth, how much was coming from salary markup, and whatever. So why not testing also this as a complement or alternative explanation? So to sum up, I like the model a lot. I think that is powerful and can be used to learn a lot of things and to explain many things that we have observed. I think that these demographics should be discussed as alternative complementary story a bit more, but still, as I said, the paper was really a draft, so maybe it was coming anyway. And I think that the model can be used to explain a bit the build-up of the pre-2011 euro area imbalances, so it should be used to do that. And finally, also, this TFP divergence can be tested in it in order to get a quantitative assessment. And that's it.